But you know, next year they're going to have what's already started called the presidential campaign, right? Campaign of 2016. And there was the campaign of 2000, the campaign of 1980, the campaign of 1960, Kennedy Nixon. Remember that? And some of you do.
I do.
My young fellows here. Ann was talking about these old people. Well, us young people aren't ready to give in yet, us young people. Who knows about the campaign of 1963? Do you know about that one in Birmingham? The Birmingham campaign of 1963, April the 3rd, it began with coordinated marches and sit-ins against racism and racial segregation in Birmingham, Alabama. The protesters, they were shot with high-pressure water hoses. Police dogs were commanded to attack these people who were simply doing quiet, peaceful protests. And on April the 12th, Dr. Martin Luther King was roughly arrested with his trusted friend Ralph Abernathy and other marchers, while thousands of African Americans were dressed for Good Friday and looked on. King met with unusually harsh conditions in the Birmingham jail. A newspaper on that date actually contained an article called A Call for Unity. Interesting title, huh? A Call for Unity. And in this article, there was a statement made by 8 white Alabama clergymen who were writing against King and his methods of civil disobedience. And that letter inspired King to write what has become known as the Birmingham Letter. And in that letter, Dr. King wrote this, and I quote, "One who breaks an unjust law must do so openly, lovingly, and with willingness to accept the penalty. I submit that an individual who breaks a law that conscience tells him is unjust and who willingly accepts the penalty of imprisonment in order to arouse the conscience of the community over its injustice is in reality expressing the highest respect for law." He continues, "Of course, there is nothing new about this kind of civil disobedience. It was evidenced sublimely in the refusal of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to obey the laws of Nebuchadnezzar on the ground that a higher moral law was at stake. It was practiced superbly by the early Christians who were willing to face hungry lions and the excruciating pain of chopping blocks rather than to submit to certain unjust laws of the Roman Empire. To a degree, academic freedom is a reality today because Socrates practiced civil disobedience. In our nation, the Boston Tea Party represented a massive act of civil disobedience. We should never forget that everything Adolf Hitler did in Germany was legal, and everything the Hungarian freedom fighters did in Hungary was illegal. It was illegal to aid and comfort a Jew in Hitler's Germany. Even so, I am sure that had I lived in Germany at the time, I would have aided and comforted my Jewish brothers. If today, and remember he's writing in 1963, if today I lived in a communist country where certain principles dear to the Christian faith are suppressed, I would openly advocate disobeying that country's anti-religious laws." And Dr. King began writing this on some smuggled-in newspaper, on the margins of newspaper that a janitor at the jail smuggled into him. He was later given a legal pad to write on by one of his lawyers after he was finally allowed to see a lawyer. Dr. King, Ralph Abernathy, Fred Shuttlesworth, and others were victims of racial segregation laws. And following in the steps of Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Gandhi, and others, their civil disobedience led to changes in the mind of society and in the laws of America. But friends, according to Revelation chapter 13, there is coming, and soon, a law of religious segregation that no civil disobedience will overcome or change the attitude of those in charge of those laws. The persecution will be more than hitting quiet demonstrators with high-pressure hoses, or being attacked by police dogs. Not just liberty, not just the pursuit of justice will be attacked, but very life itself. And yes, here in America. How shall we endure persecution? Did Jesus experience any persecution? May I refer you to John chapter 15 and verse 20. John chapter 15 and verse 20. And we hope everybody can hear well. John 15, verse 20. Notice the words of Jesus. He said, "Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my sayings, they will keep yours also." But we know, friends, that in the end times, the society, the majority, and even the majority of the churches are not going to be keeping the sayings of Jesus. They're going to be persecuting the followers of Jesus, because if Jesus was on earth today, they'd persecute Jesus Christ. Amen. How shall we endure? And how shall we face this? With what kind of an attitude and perspective should we look at these things? You know, Jesus knew this was coming, and he foretold this, and he told us how we could relate to these things. If you would turn with me, please, to the Sermon on the Mount as recorded in the book of Luke. Luke chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. Luke chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. And what we're going to read is not pie in the sky, friends, because we're going to show you an example in the New Testament later where this was practiced by early believers. In Luke chapter 6, verses 22 and 23, Jesus said, "Blessed are ye." Now that word blessed, what's another synonym or way that we could express that in English? Happy. Happy. "Blessed are you." Or happy are ye, it's plural, "when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake." He says, "Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner did their fathers unto the prophets." And may I say that their fathers did a little bit more than just simply say they had a bad name. But Jesus says that we can be joyful at that time. You know why, friends? Because we are counted worthy to suffer for Jesus. That is the way the disciples felt, wasn't it? Turn with me to Matthew chapter 5 and look at the parallel text in Matthew, please. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 10. Jesus said, "Blessed are ye when ye are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven," or those who are persecuted. So, It's part of our experience, friends, in being prepared for the kingdom of heaven, that in fact we have persecution. Now, how should we relate to those people who persecute us? What did Jesus say about this? Well, in the Sermon on the Mount, he gave us some understanding of this. In verses 44 and 45, he said this, "I say unto you, love your enemies." Love who?
Your enemies.
Well, I love the people in my church. I love my family. I love my dear mother. But Jesus says, if I don't do any more than that, I've only done what the Gentiles already do. He tells me here, he says, "Love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." But Lord, after the time of trouble, my witness can't help those people. Why do I have to love them? When probation closes, I can't be a witness to those people anymore. My good standing in front of them isn't going to help them anymore. Should I still love them?
Yes.
Do you think God still loves them?
Yes.
Unfortunately, for some people, they don't like this, but yes, he still loves them. And he says in Jeremiah 31 and verse 3, he says, "Yea, I've loved thee with an everlasting love." God's love will never end throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, friends. I think there's going to be a place in the heart of God that is missing Lucifer and every person who's ever lost.
Amen.
And we'll never fix that. Only the God of heaven can deal with that. Somehow. An everlasting love. But he goes on to tell us why, though, we should do this also in verse 45. "That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust." You see, friends, I've had to think a little bit in a way I've never thought before. I've been faced with a similar situation before twice, but not quite in the same way. As most of you know, my mother is in a hospice center 100 miles from here, and she's not doing well tonight. She's been in a coma for a week. To our knowledge, she has no knowledge of anything happening around her. We can speak to her, but there's no indication she hears. We do it anyhow, just in case, you know. But let's assume she doesn't hear anything. How is her character being perfected in iota at this point by her living on? She's never going to think another conscious thought. Her character is fixed for eternity right now. But God has allowed her to live on. You know why, friends? Because it's me. And it may be other people. Maybe it's my brother. Maybe it's my aunt. Maybe it's my niece. But God has, in His wisdom, ordained to allow her to live a little longer because there's something either we have to develop or we have to show to someone else or some combination thereof. Because, friends, God's not cruel. He's not a tyrant. And so even in the persecution, friends, even if those people can never, ever be saved, we will still love those people. We will do what's right because that's what Jesus said to do. And if it's for nothing else, it's for the universe to vindicate the character of God and what righteousness is like. You remember what Jesus said when He was on the cross? Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. And we are to have, as Brother Estee said, the mind of Jesus, right? The mind of Jesus. We have to have that mind, Philippians 2:5. And that was the mindset of Jesus all the way through, friends. And if we're going to be saved at last and be a part of that great remnant people, 144,000 that Brother Andy was talking about this afternoon, then we have to have the mind of Jesus Christ, and it has to be a mind of love, even for those who despitefully use us and persecute us. Now let's turn to Acts chapter 5 and verse 41, please. Acts chapter 5 and verse 41. You remember the apostles, they had been called in and they'd been sort of dealt with. And they said, now you go and you don't preach this man's name anymore. And verse 41 says, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for His name. And so, beloved, it shouldn't necessarily be our prayer to avoid persecution. We don't want to bring it on. We're not there to try to provoke it. But if God allows us to be a part of suffering for the name of Christ, then we should rejoice. Amen. and be thankful. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, please. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. We're going to read verses 4 and 5. He says, knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Verse 6, and ye became followers of us, and the Lord, having received the word with word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Spirit. We received it with much what? Affliction. Do you like affliction? I mean, human nature doesn't usually like affliction. It's not something that we prefer to have in our experience. But how was it before? Well, you know, Dr. King, he mentioned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And I think that they've been mentioned here at least once in this camping so far. But think about them. They were given a choice whether to serve Nebuchadnezzar or not, to obey that law or not. And they chose not to obey because it was an unjust law. It was the wrong kind of law. Did God honor them? Now, they committed what we would today call peaceful civil disobedience. They didn't put up a fight. They didn't even flee. They knew what was going to happen. They were people high up in the government. They knew what was coming. But they stayed around and they openly, lovingly, disobeyed that law. And God approved of that. And He showed His approval by keeping them through everlasting devouring fire like we talked about yesterday in our science demonstration. Then think about the situation with Daniel. Daniel in the lion's den. Again, there was a decree. A decree was made. And yet Daniel openly, purposefully, openly disobeyed that command. Lovingly disobeyed that command. And God honored him. And God taught all of the generations after him a lesson by his example. And a lesson by the example of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They didn't run and hide. They didn't obey the law. They performed civil disobedience. Now, Dr. King also wrote this in his letter. I'd like to read to you. He says, "One may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others? The answer lies in the fact that there are two types of laws, just and unjust. I would be the first to advocate obeying just laws. One has not only a legal but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws." Now, I'll expound on this just a little bit more later. But Dr. King really didn't understand what made a just law and an unjust law. But he was getting close. But we know, as Seventh-day Adventists, we know from studying our Bibles and principles of religious liberty that the first four commandments of the Decalogue, Caesar has no right to touch. Is that right? You agree with me? Any amens?
Amen.
Okay. But the second table of the Decalogue, he has a right to keep society in civil order. Now I want to read you a couple texts. The first one's in Titus chapter 3 and verse 1. Titus chapter 3 and verse 1. "Put them in mind to be subject to principalities and powers, to obey magistrates, to be ready to every good work." He's talking about the believers here. Titus, you do this. And he says, you teach them to obey the magistrates. You teach them to obey those powers, those principalities who are in power. That's what Paul said, didn't he? Okay. Turn with me to Romans 13 now. You knew I was going there eventually, right? And we'll start reading in verse 1. It says, "Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God." Wait a minute. No power but of God? Well, isn't that what Daniel said in Daniel chapter 2, that he sets up kings and he takes down kings? "There is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God." Verse 2, Romans chapter 13, verse 2 now. It says, "Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore, ye must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake." Verse 6. For this cause pay ye tribute also, for they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor." I'm missing someone that should be here right now. Well, do you think Paul meant these words? Are we to obey these words?
Yes.
But it seems to me, then Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were bad guys because they didn't seem to obey. But they were serving God. The same God that Paul was serving, right? The same God who says, "I change not."
They were obeying the highest power.
And we'll talk more about that in a minute. But you know, friends, we cannot, and I'm going to make this clear, we cannot sustain an extreme position based upon this text. There are people who will take this text, and they'll read it superficially, and they will say, you know, it doesn't matter what the government says, you do it. And you're responsible to God for doing it. It reminds me of a situation where a brother had a particular doctrine. And this brother had a doctrine about how husbands and wives relate to each other. And the Bible says that the husband is the head of the home, doesn't it? Does it say that? Is that true? Does it say he's the dictator of the home? Does it say he's the absolute lord of the home? No. Although Sarah called Abraham Lord, didn't she? That's what the Bible says. But this man had come to a theology to this point that his wife was to obey him in everything, and by this doing this, she was to serve God by doing this. And so the question was asked him, well, what if the husband asked the wife to shoot someone and murder them? And the man said the wife is duty-bound to do it. And if it's wrong, then God will deal with the wrong through the husband who executed the order. But her responsibility is to follow the husband. And there are people who feel like that our responsibility, based on a superficial reading of these texts, is to follow whatever the government tells us. And yet, at the same time, it says that we are to be in subjection to them. The powers that be, which are ordained of God, friends, are only ordained in matters that pertain to the outward peace of society. That which is delineated in the second table of the Decalogue. He says to render honor to whom honor is due. That's part of the command. But you know, in the Old Testament, the book of 1 Samuel, I think it's in chapter 2, God said, those who honor me, I will honor. Do we owe honor to God?
Yes.
We do owe honor to God, friends, and so we have a due to give honor to God, first and foremost. But this is a different kind of honor that we are to give government. In Matthew chapter 22, if we could turn there. Matthew chapter 22 and verse 21. Jesus here gives us a very basic principle. They brought in the coin. They said, do we pay tribute on this? Here's the coin. And Jesus said, whose superscription is on it? They said, Caesar's. And he said unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things which or that are God's. And so Jesus is teaching us that there are two spheres of duty here. Paul says you give honor to who honor is due, duty to who duty is due, and so on. But there are two areas, and they're different, and they're distinct. And one is to God, and the other is to Caesar. And these two subjections are not to be in conflict with each other. In Daniel chapter 3 and Daniel chapter 6, we see examples of not obeying every command. And the apostles set a similar example. King alluded to it also. He said the apostles also. If you look with me in Acts chapter 4, and verse 15. I'll start in verse 15. Here again, the apostles have been called in by the higher authorities. It says, but when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men? For that indeed a notable miracle hath been done by them is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But that it spread no further among the people, let us straitly threaten them, that they speak henceforth to no man in this name. And they called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. Now these religious leaders, they weren't the Roman government, and they didn't have the same jurisdiction as the Roman government, but I'm going to tell you, friends, to the Jewish people, they held a higher position of government and allegiance than the Romans did by any means. And in fact, they did have, to a great degree, a certain amount of local autonomy that was given by the Roman Empire to them that they gave to no other group of people in all their empire. But notice what it goes on to say, verse 19 and 20. But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye, for we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. In other words, we're going to put you on notice right now. You can say this to us. And if you choose to flog us, if you choose to put us away, we're still going to say this anyhow. It was like when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were there on the plain of Durham, and they said, you know, we're not careful to answer you, King. We don't have to be careful because we already know what we're going to do, and we know why we're going to do it, and we're going to do it.
Amen.
And I don't think very many of us have that backbone today. Some of us know the history of the Adventist Church in Russia and in parts of Germany during World War I especially, and that time thereafter, when what we today now call or know as the Seventh-day Adventist Reform Movement came into being. And it came into being over the issue of how the church and the state were going to relate to each other. And if the church was going to allow the state to command it, in not only simply in matters of civil authority, but in sacred authority. And the fact is that the majority of the Adventist people in Russia, the majority of the Adventist people in Germany, capitulated to the governments. And those who wouldn't had to either go underground or start a separate movement. In Russia, they went underground. And in 1930 and on, the Adventist churches carried Nazi swastika flags in them. They said Heil Hitler. They even put up signs on Adventist churches, no Jews are welcome here. Yeah, because they wanted to get along with Hitler, because they knew if they didn't, that they, like the Jehovah's Witnesses, who stayed pretty faithful, to be honest with you, they would go to Auschwitz, like the Jehovah's Witnesses did. And I want to tell you, I think that those Russian people probably were a lot more down-to-earth, salt people than we are in America today. In America today, in the last century, we have become such soft people. Now, I have certain devices and I have certain things that are, I suppose, luxuries today. And I saw something today, and it doesn't matter whose vehicle was on, but I've seen it on other ones too. But I saw one of the doors on a van, and the door just slowly, you know, going up and down because it has an electric motor to it, you know. We don't even open up our own doors anymore. We let a motor do it, you know. We're soft people, and we're soft not only physically, but morally. Morally, we are soft people, and we were cracking. I'm going to tell you what, the Seventh-day Adventist people are some of the softest. And they capitulated to the Bolsheviks, and they will capitulate again. You can bet on it. And it's only going to be the little flock, those people who know their God, as we mentioned from Daniel 11 the other night, that are really going to do what's right and stand strong for God. These apostles refused to keep silence, and they went right on teaching, though the rulers had told them not to say anything. And when they were brought again before the council and reminded of the injunction which they had been laid upon them, they boldly replied, "We ought to obey God rather than men." Acts 5:29. Now all of these cases, and especially the last, show that the command to be subject to the powers that be, it doesn't mean that we should obey them when obedience to them involves disobedience to God. Now the question then arises, were these men subject to the governments under which they lived? Can men be subject to the powers that be and yet not obey them in every particular, no matter what they command? If we believe Paul, the answer must be yes. There must be some way to be subject to the governments, even if we don't obey them. And I would like to propose to you that men indeed can be subject to the powers that be and still disobey them when their decrees conflict with the laws of God. And the record shows most clearly that this was the case in Daniel. It was the case of his fellows and the case of the apostles. They were subject to the powers that existed at that time. Now, one of these persons who was civilly disobedient that we read about here in Acts wrote about this later. It's in 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. And I'm going to start in verse 17. I'm probably going to say something not popular, but that's okay. I love you anyhow. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. But the text doesn't stop there, does it?
Honor the king.
Honor the king. If he's a good guy.
Nope.
Honor the king. If he'll vote with Seventh-day Adventists. Honor the king if he doesn't impose the wrong taxes on me. It says honor the king. Honor the king. Now I want to tell you something, friends. There is, and we know it's true, there is a mentality that is amongst us at times that says that our president is bad and he is evil, and we have every right to speak against him, to make false accusations against him, and I get them all the time in emails. You know, Obama wasn't born in America, or Obama's really a Muslim. And he may be. It doesn't matter. It says honor the king. The text says honor him. Respect that office, even if you don't agree with him. That's what it says. It's not all it says. It says, servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. For this is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. Suffering how?
Wrongfully.
You're disobeying a bad law, and you're suffering wrongfully when you shouldn't have to suffer. But he says that God will bless you when you do that. Verse 20. For what glory is it when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently. But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable to God. To honor the king shows this to be then a parallel passage to what Paul's writing in Romans chapter 13. Here, as there, we are exhorted to be subject to rulers, even if they are not good. That's what the Bible says. But this doesn't mean, it does not mean that we should disobey God in honoring them. This is evident from what it says here in verse 19 that we read about suffering wrongfully. The fact that the Christian is called upon to suffer wrongfully and that he is buffeted because he does well shows that his doing right has been in direct opposition to the commands of the civil authorities. Now, we live in a society today of laws, and there are more laws than Carter has pills. And one of those laws says that when you're out on the common highway, the speed limit is 55. But that's okay, I can disobey that one, right?
You can go 65.
I can go 65. I can go. I mean, if the policeman's not there, it doesn't matter, right?
Oh,
it does matter. But you see, for every law, there's a penalty. If I'm driving 65 in a 55-mile-an-hour zone, in fact, I used to teach driver education. I had a student come to me one time and said, Mr. Stump, I got a ticket for doing 26 miles an hour in a 25-mile-an-hour zone. I said, really? Because usually they don't get you that close, right? I said, where'd you get that ticket at? He said, I got down Kimball. I said, well, you should have known better. At that time, there was a lot of speed trap at Kimball. But the fact is that every time you break a law, there is a penalty to that law. You will pay a fine, or you'll lose your license, or a combination, or something will happen. There's no real law, friends, without a penalty. There was a young man who grew up not too far from this area several years ago. His name was Tommy Pridemore. And Tommy Pridemore was one of the best athletes that the state of West Virginia's ever had. He went to West Virginia University, starred there on the football team, made the Hall of Fame in West Virginia, played for the Atlanta Falcons for 8 years as a professional football player. And in fact, to my knowledge, he's the only professional football player who was actually, at the same time, also an active legislator. He was a member of the West Virginia State Legislature for a while. And this is back several years ago now. We're going back about 40 years. And he was, this was before, if you were a hunter, today you have to wear a certain amount of blaze orange when you're out in the woods hunting. It's a safety thing. But this was before the blaze orange was required. And so he had a bill he was producing to the legislature requiring people to wear a certain amount of blaze orange. But he said in his speech introducing, he said, I want to make it very clear, there's no penalty for breaking this law. We're not going to fine people, but, you know, this is going to be the law. But it was, of course, a stupid law. You know, he was trying to encourage people to wear the blaze orange, but he realized at that time that if they tried to make it a law with a penalty, it'd probably never get passed. And I don't think it got passed anyhow. But there's no law that is really a law without some kind of penalty for its violation. And Peter says that the Christian suffers for conscience' sake toward God. And that is that his conscience will not allow him to disobey God's commandment in obedience to some higher power or master or civil authority, the powers that be. And so instead, he patiently suffers with it. And although he can't obey his master's command, his patient acceptance of the threatened punishment shows his subjection to that power. Did you get that? Probably didn't get that. Let me say it again. Although he can't obey the master's command, his patient acceptance of the threatened punishment shows his subjection to the power. And so we see by this, beloved, that being subject to the higher powers that be, the powers that be, means simply that we are to obey them when their commands are right. We are to disobey them when they are in conflict with those of the law of God. And yet, if we must do that, we must meekly be willing to accept the consequences. Because the law says you must, for instance, drive 55 miles an hour or you pay a fine. Okay, I pay the fine. You must go to church on Sunday or pay a fine. Okay, I'll pay the fine. But I'm not going to obey this law. But this is how I will be subject and show honor to the government. That's what Paul's saying. It may not be popular, it may not be what you thought, but that's what Paul's saying. It's what Peter's saying. Daniel and his companions did not resist, but they did not obey an unrighteous commandment. The Bible everywhere teaches respect for authority. And nowhere does it teach anarchy or warrant us to have contempt for authority. Rebellion against authority is not countenance under any circumstances, friends. Every soul must be subject to the powers that be, and that subjection consists in willing, prompt obedience to all their laws when they do not require disobedience of God's law. And I think that includes the 55 mile an hour speed limit. And we willingly accept the penalty for disobeying laws that run against the law of God. An example of this is found in the early Christian church, those who joyfully took the spoiling of their goods. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 34, I said we'd show you an example of people who followed that counsel. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 34. He says, "For ye had compassion of me in my bonds." You know why Paul was in prison? Because he disobeyed. "And took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance." And a couple other translations of that text say, "For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property." Let me just stop there. Wait a minute. Joyfully accepted the plundering of your property. Now, wait a minute. I thought that when the ATF or the FBI came to my house, I was supposed to have a big arsenal there ready to fight them and keep them from taking my property. But the text says, "You joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one." You see, friends, if our hearts and minds are really centered on this earth and the things of this earth, we're going to do everything we can to protect that. But if we realize that we have a heavenly home, the things here aren't important, friends.
Amen.
Another translation says, "For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and a lasting one." Friends, where there cannot be obedience, there must not be resistance. David would not lift up his hand against the king of Israel, even though that king was most unjustly seeking his life. Paul would not knowingly speak ill of the high priest, although the priest was a wicked hypocrite. But I'm sure right now you're asking in your mind, why didn't Brother Allen speak to us about Matthew 10, 22 and 23? So let's turn to Matthew 10, 22 and 23.
Matthew 10?
Matthew 10. Matthew 10, verses 22 and 23. Jesus, in Matthew 10, is going to send his disciples out for their first great missionary tour. And he's giving them some instruction. And notice what he says. "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." Now that's a good place to stop for just a minute. We're talking about what? The end? And we want to endure to win?
The end.
If we do, we'll be what?
Saved.
Very good. Let's go continue, class. "But when they shall persecute you in this city, flee into another. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. It seems to me he's saying here, don't just comply with them, just flee. What can this mean to us? Well, let's look at another verse, and that's in Matthew 24, and then we'll come back to this. Matthew 24, you know what verse 15 is about. Let's read it, and verse 16 also at the same time. Matthew chapter 24, verses 15 and 16. Jesus said, he's talking about the signs of the destruction of Jerusalem and the end of the world, and he says in verse 15, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whosoever leadeth, let him understand, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. And so in these two verses, it seems like Jesus is telling us that there is indeed a time to flee. There's going to be a time to stand, but there's also going to be a time to flee. Now, it's interesting that the Greek word translated persecute means to flee. I'm sorry, it doesn't mean to flee. It means to persecute or to pursue. And so when someone's pursuing you, you've got to be fleeing for someone to pursue you. Do you get it? Maybe I need to say that again. I didn't give it to you clear the first time, so let me say it again. The Greek word that's translated persecute means to pursue.
Chase.
Or to chase. That's good. To chase. That's a good synonym. And so if someone's being chased, that means someone's fleeing. Someone's fleeing. It seems to imply a fleeing, but this fleeing is, I believe, as you look at the context, a general fleeing, and it is more to spread the message than to protect ourselves. In other words, if I see that there's problems coming up in this city, I can go over here where maybe I can work in freedom and do that and spread the gospel. Now, in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 6, on page 478, we have this counsel. Volume 6, page 478. When they persecute you in this city, flee you to another. If persecution comes there, go to still another place. God will lead his people, making them a blessing in many places. Were it not for persecution, they would not be so widely scattered abroad to proclaim the truth. And Christ declares, you shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man become, Matthew 10:23. Until in heaven is spoken the word, it is finished. There will always be places for labor and hearts to receive the message. And then there's another statement in Volume 9 of the Testimonies on page 236. And there we read, when they persecute you in this city, flee you to another. It is not the will of God that your lives shall be carelessly sacrificed. Verily I say unto you, you shall not have gone over all the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. Quoting again from Matthew 10:23. So there's a line that we have to draw between accepting some persecution and fleeing from other persecution. And tonight I'm going to be a little bit like my brother Andy. I'm going to let you decide and draw that line tonight. But we need to understand. We need to understand that there's a line that has to be drawn. And sometimes we may have to flee indeed. And other times we just have to stand because there's a wrong principle and someone's got to stand for it and stand against it and for what's right. Now, I want you to turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 4 because we need to look now at overcoming during persecution. We need to look at something about how we're going to live now. We've talked about the attitude that we have, that we do indeed submit ourselves to the higher powers and how we have to do that and that our attitude is to be a loving attitude toward them. But how are we going to make it through this time personally? And that's what we need to look at. 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12 is where we'll start. He says, Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you. Now, trials come in a lot of different, you know, shapes, sizes, and colors. But there are going to be trials of persecution, friends. Trials from civil authorities and trials from religious authorities. And we have to be willing and able to endure those trials. And he says in verse 13, but rejoice. Now, if I was to hit my thumb with a hammer really hard, I probably wouldn't rejoice. You might not either. The Bible says, in all things, give thanks. That's a little harder to do at that time, but you can do it anyhow. I might not rejoice so much. But you know, friends, God has a purpose in everything. And if he allows persecution to come to me, then I'm to rejoice in that, because that's exactly what his word says. Inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. There's something about this, friends, this experience, that when Jesus does come, we're going to have greater joy and a greater experience. And the fact is that we may be there to see Jesus come and to go be taken up in the clouds of heaven with him, that we wouldn't be without the persecution. I think I'd certainly rejoice for that. Let's read on. Verse 14. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody even, in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glory God on his behalf. For the time has come, the judgment must begin at the house of God, and if it first begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? He says that we can take joy in this persecution, knowing that it is a sign that we are God's children. Now, not everyone who's been ever persecuted was a child of God. I mentioned to you there, if you've ever been to Auschwitz, I've been there twice. You can go in there and you can see the pictures and you can look at copies of the records and you'll see a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses there. A lot of Jewish people there. These people don't accept Jesus as the Son of God, as the Savior of the world. See? And they were still persecuted. And so there is a type of persecution that's not a godly persecution at all. You know, the German people in World War II, they killed almost every Russian prisoner. Because they were Russians, not because of their religious faith. They just didn't like Russians. You know? These people who they supposedly had signed a peace treaty with a few years before that. But in this time, friends, and it is going to come, and we are going to be involved, and it is soon, we need to learn to rely upon the mercies of God. And we need to claim the promises of God. And we'll look at some of those promises in a minute. But let's turn to Lamentations chapter 3, in verses 22 and 23. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Beloved, we can depend upon the mercies of God at this time, and we can know that every day those mercies are new. You read stories. There was a story recently in the news about a man who had served 46 years in solitary confinement for a crime he might not have even committed. And to our knowledge, no man in America, maybe anywhere in the world, has lived 46 years of his life in total solitary confinement other than this man. And that seems a long time to live in a box that's about 5 feet by 7 feet. No window that you can ever see outside into the rest of the world in. But you know what? The Bible says if I'm put in that box, or if I'm put in a smaller box or a more difficult situation, God's mercies are new every day. Amen. I've been here for 10 years. That's okay. Today is a new day, and God's mercies are new today. Amen. They're new each day. And we have been locked up for weeks, months, or even years, and God's mercies are still new every day. Romans chapter 8 and verse 18. But friends, if we're not partaking of these precious promises, if we're, you know, I just pray the Lord doesn't have to give us a stroke like ST had, so we sit around and meditate more on the Word of God. That's what he told us this morning. He said, had this stroke, sit around, meditate on the Word of God more. I don't want that to happen to me. I'm not saying it happened because he didn't, but that's what his case happened to be. But in Romans chapter 8 and verse 18, if we could turn there. Romans chapter 8 and verse 18. And I'll be with you in just a minute. Paul says, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Amen.
Are we going to have sufferings as Christians? Yea, all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But he says we're not worthy to be reckoned. If we go to verse 35, he tells us, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Will any of those things separate us from the love of God in Christ? No. We can walk away from it. I can walk away tomorrow. I can walk away tonight. but there's no devil. There's no company of devils that is strong enough, skilled enough, that can anyway separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. 1 John 4:4. Mac has a thought or something.
I thought maybe you could tell them, you probably know about Kent Hovind.
He was recently released from prison, I understand.
Yes, and all the charges were dropped.
Okay.
They put him in there for no reason.
Yeah. He was in there for about how long? 10 years?
9 years.
9 years.
Yeah. But he was able to win many people to the Lord.
Yes. By his faithful witness there. That's good. Well, God has a purpose for everything, and he may separate us from our loved ones. That's possible. And in fact, probable at times. He may separate us from the rest of our church family. And Satan can separate us from a lot of things in this world, but friends, he can never, ever separate us from Christ. He says, nay, in verse 37, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, I never thought of height or depth as a creature, but nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's a precious promise that we need to hold on to. Another one's in 2 Timothy 3, verses 10 and 11. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 and 11. Paul says, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. How many, Albert?
All
of them. It says all, doesn't it? The Lord delivered him out of all those persecutions. Now, did that mean Paul was never stoned? No, Paul was stoned. He was stoned to death, it appears. But the Lord raised him up. Did Paul ever have to be in a ship that went down? More than once. More than once. Was he ever beaten with rods? Yeah, more than once. So he had persecutions. He didn't always have an easy rose bed to walk upon. But the Lord sustained him through them all, and the Lord promises to sustain us through them all as well. Isn't that right?
Amen.
I like what Paul says in Hebrews 13 verse 6. Hebrews 13 verse 6. By the way, verse 12, it comes right after that. It's where he says, all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall be suffer persecution. Hebrews 13, 6. Do we know who wrote the book of Hebrews?
Paul.
How do we know that?
Paul already said it. Yeah.
That's right. It's good enough for me. Spirit of prophecy tells us that. It doesn't say inside the epistle. A lot of people don't believe Paul wrote it. But I believe it's consistent with his writings all the way through. And the Spirit of prophecy tells us that. And so Paul says in verse 6 of Hebrews 13, so that we may boldly say, how are we going to say it?
Boldly
say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear what man shall do unto me. And men can do things unto us sometimes. Men can do things to us sometimes. But one thing they can never do is take your soul. They can never take your soul. Revelation chapter 3. And because we are pre-millennial, pre-tribulation or post-tribulation people, we understand this text. It says, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon, Revelation 3:10, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world, to try them that dwell upon the earth. He keeps us, but friends, he doesn't keep us out of it, he keeps us in it. In that tribulation, in that time. Now, as mentioned, there were promises that we wanted to trust in. And we read one in Hebrews 13, 6, and I want to go back to Hebrews 13. Because verse 5, which you probably already know, should be read also here. We'll read it also. But Paul says, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And so when I'm stuck in a prison alone, or when my my property's been taken from me. Maybe I'll be able to joyfully be glad that that happened, because the Lord is with me and He's promised not to leave me or forsake me. And He's promised to help me in that time of temptation. And I'd like to also read, I'd like to read some from Psalms 23 tonight. Psalms 23. Psalms 23, if we could. Verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Even in the presence of our enemies, those who would persecute us, those who would bring us, ST, to the point of the valley of the shadow of death. We all want to do different things throughout our lives. We have what we call a bucket list. You know, on my mother's bucket list for this year was to come down to this camp meeting for one day and hear her son preach. And she's heard me preach for the last time she'll ever hear me preach. We don't know, friends. We don't know when the last time we'll ever hear the gospel appeal given to us will be. None of us have the guarantee that we're going to walk out of this building and live till tomorrow morning. But we can trust God. Even if He leads us through the valley of the shadow of death, even if we are in the midst of our enemies, we can trust Him. In Isaiah 43, verse 2, He says, When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. And verse 5, He says, Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east, and gather thee from the west. These are promises, friends, that we can learn and we can hold on to. And we may not be free from trials, but we're always in the help of God, no matter what the situation. In 2 Corinthians, if we go back to the New Testament, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 9. And this text says, We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Well, he goes on to say we're persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed. This is the experience of the people of God. This can be our experience, and I pray that it will be. I've got a lot more I'd like to preach about tonight, and it's almost time to end. But maybe we should have a prayer. It's sundown right now. I'd like to have a prayer for sundown, and then if you'll give me just a few more minutes, if you would, then we'll continue just a little bit. Father in heaven, we thank you for the Sabbath. But Father, we've been blessed in many ways this Sabbath, and I can't argue with the blessing you've given us, but somehow I'd like to have a little bit more. And so, Father, even though we may be past the legal time of the Sabbath, we still want, Father, the blessing of your presence. So please bless us just a little bit more now, and I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Is it okay if I speak just a little bit more?
Yeah, go ahead.
We're not going to be free from trials, but friends, we have weapons at our disposal. You know, we have the Bible speaks about the Christian armor in Ephesians 6. We read about it at the baptism today. And one of the things that Ephesians 6 speaks about in verse 18 is to always be praying. Always be praying. And in Psalms 143 and verse 9, David says he's pleading for deliverance. And we can plead for deliverance too. The Lord is our light in darkness. And we can pray to Him and He will hear us. Now one text that we spoke about on Tuesday night was in 1 Peter 4:7. And I won't reread it, but there Peter says that the end of all things is at hand. And we found out Tuesday night that there's more than one end. But the end of all things is at hand, and we need to be praying and trusting in the promises, depending upon the mercies of God, because, friends, the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back soon, and He's going to get the kingdom and take it to Himself. And we can be part of the kingdom, or we can be left behind. But in Revelation 11, it says, a seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our Lord and of His Christ. And He shall reign forever and ever. Friends, He is able to keep us from falling. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11 tells us that the saints overcome by the word of their testimony and by what else? The blood of the Lamb. That's right. Now, I do have to finish one part that I said I would tell you about later. Dr. Martin Luther King led an important movement in the 1960s. And that focus was on a type of equality. But even Dr. King could not see all the real issues. From Birmingham, from that jail, he wrote these words. Listen to them carefully. An unjust law is a code that a numerical or power majority group compels a minority group to obey but does not make binding on itself. This is difference made legal. By the same token, a just law is a code that the majority compels a minority to follow and that it is willing to follow itself. Is that true? If you're thinking only of civil rights due to racial issues, maybe it's okay. But I'm going to tell you, friends, according to Revelation 13, there's coming an oppressive power that is going to create a law that says that everybody is going to bow down to the brainchild of the papacy, which is really energized by Satan. And the majority are not going to ask the minority to do anything they themselves are not willing to do. They're going to be willing to do it all just right along with them, aren't they? They're going to keep Sunday just like they want the minority, the little flock, to keep Sunday. And friends, that doesn't make it a just law. You see? And so in this one place, Dr. King didn't quite see far enough. He saw far enough for the thing he was doing in his time. Amen. But friends, we're in a different time. We're 50 years later, and we have a greater, bigger, eternal issue that even Dr. King never faced in this respect. On this Wednesday, I don't know if you've kept up with the news any, but on this Wednesday, June the 10th, Russian President Vladimir Putin arrived at the Vatican Wednesday afternoon for a meeting with Pope Francis. Maybe you knew that. It is suggested that the reason for the visit was the situation in Ukraine, around the Crimea area. Now, Russia doesn't like the international sanctions of economics sanctions that have been posed against her, and Putin is looking to the Pope for help. The Pope has angered, in fact, many Catholics in Ukraine because, interestingly, in his search for peace, he has supposedly failed to condemn, or has clearly failed to condemn, Russia in this act of aggression. Now, Putin is looking to the Pope for help. We know that President Obama has visited both former Pope Benedict and this last year Pope Francis as well. And we know that on September 24th of this year, the Pope, oh, by the way, here I did have a slide of Putin meeting with Francis this last week. But on September the 24th of this year, the Pope is going to address a joint session in the United States Congress, which has never in the history of this country ever been done. And there are people who are saying, well, this is a specific prophecy, and this is something that tells us it's time to flee. Now, I don't know if they're all thinking that we should flee America, or flee to the country, or out of the cities, or what. But I will just say this. At a minimum, these are coming events that are casting shadows. Right. Coming events cast their shadows before. And this papal power will soon rear its ugly head. But in the New World, the Americas, We are told that it will use apostate Protestantism. Catholicism in the old world, Protestantism in the new world. And through her daughters, apostate Protestantism, she will work, especially through those desirous of world recognition, those who are already experienced at using the civil authorities to obtain their wishes. But beloved, we can be ready for the end so that we can all stand together at the end of the end. Now we've come to the end of the camp meeting, but we're not at the end yet, and we're not at the end of the end. But if we will stand now and stand each day, then friends, when the end of the end comes, we'll all be standing with Jesus. And that's what we want to do, isn't it? We can be those who are the called, the chosen, and faithful as we abide in our commander and our high priest. We can be faithful as we depend upon the mercies of God, trust in His promises, and especially those of His presence as we pray always. And that's my appeal to you tonight. That you put the Word of God in your heart and make it a part of your very being. You know, the Apostle James speaks of it as, and uses the phrase, the engrafted Word. The engrafted Word. It's been grafted into us. It's a part of us now. So that we have these promises and we understand these mercies and we can call upon Him in our time of need. And we are going to have a time of need. The Lord's not going to lay every one of us to rest before that time. He may lay some of us to rest. It's possible. But I dare say most of us are living in this generation that are going to see these final events happen. And friends, I want to be part of that called, chosen, faithful. I want to be a part of God's Navy SEALs. I really do. And I want you to also. We are told that each one of us should strive with all of our power to become a part of the 144,000. And I believe in that. I believe in that. And I want to have that character, which is developed by habits. And habits come from our actions. And the actions are provoked by the things that we think. The things that we think. So that I can stand in that day. And I know you do too. Sister Sandy is going to sing a song for us, and then we're going to have a prayer.
To the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore, till we gather in heaven's bright city. Far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the beautiful river of life, where the charming roses bloom forever, and separations come no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore.
Before I have prayer, it's the last chance I have to say anything to you as a group. And I want to thank you for coming to this camp meeting, and I want to thank you for allowing me to be gone for most of this camp meeting this time. And if my mother could have seen ahead a week and know what's happened, I think she'd want me to thank you for letting me be gone too. She loves so many of you. And I want to thank you for loving her too. Our Father, we thank Thee that Thou art indeed God, and that there is none other like Thee. We thank Thee, Father, for the Lord Jesus Christ and His goodness to us, for His sacrifice for our sins, that we can have eternal life. This evening, Father, we know not when our probation will close. It could be very unexpected. And we, Father, must be ready. We're talking about preparing for the end, and that sounds like something that's happening in the future. But we are here. And Jesus didn't tell us, Father, to get ready. He said, be ready. So tonight, if there's anyone here who's not made their calling election sure, Father, my plea to that soul tonight is to trust in Jesus. Or if we've made a profession of faith before and we have backslidden or not lived as we ought, Father, I pray that you will touch that soul to repent and to turn back to you. Father, I know there's been offenses. I know that people have been hurt. And I'm so sorry for that. And I don't know how to fix these things, but we trust that you do. And so, Father, I ask that in your love and in your goodness, you will indeed have mercy, that we will recognize your mercies that are new every day. I don't know if some will be leaving tonight, tomorrow, next few days, to go back to their homes or their places of labor. But may each one have a safe and blessed experience in their travels, that they might be returned to their homes or loved ones or their field of labor, wherever it may be. And Father, that Jesus will come soon, the work will close, and Father, may this be our last camp meeting ever. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.